few minutes I'll be talking to you on the management of the diabetic macular edema. We know this is classically the classification of diabetic maculopathy, and we'll be dealing mainly with the focal and the diffuse types and what we call now the center involving macular edema. This is the classical ETDRS definition of clinically significant macular edema with thickening within 1 disc diameter of the center of the macula. So we all know that in the options in DME are good metabolic control, laser, anti-VEGF agents, intravitreal steroids, and in some situations, pars plena vitrectomy where there is a tractional component. And good metabolic control is important and is vital irrespective of whether and what intervention is chosen. Focal macular edema is a relatively simple problem, and most of the times if it is not center involving, you can do laser photocoagulation, and we see here on the OCT a good response and the macula dries up, and very often you can have a permanently dry macula after this treatment. Diffuse macular edema is a little more tricky problem, where we need to employ other modalities of treatment, and if we do laser indiscriminately, there is a chance of losing vision in these cases with deposition of hard exudates in the fovea. So that's what led to the advent or development of these other modalities, and of which the anti-VEGF agents are the most prominent, as anti-permeability factor in this situation is the most important mode of action. When we talk of anti-VEGF agents in DME, we are talking mainly of center-involving macular edema where the central foveal thickness is greater than 250 microns, vision less than about 6.9. In symptomatic patients, the vision may be even better than 6.9, but you may still opt to treat. In addition, we would do laser to the non-perfused areas at the posterior pole and in the periphery. Now we know with wide-angle angiography in some refractory cases, and to sources of leak which are extrafoveal. But we prefer to do the laser after the edema has decreased. That is, deferred laser is generally found to give better results than immediate laser in these cases. So here we see Avastin in diabetic macular edema. Pre and post injection, the macula has dried up. But again, we also know very well that this is not permanent. They can get recurrences, which can be sometimes even more marked than the initial macular edema. So that has led to the combination here again in the fact that after the you dry up the macula with anti-VEGFs, doing a laser is a good idea if you can find focal lesions, especially extrafoveal, to treat, and that makes the reduction of edema more permanent. So coming to the retreatment strategies with anti-VEGFs in DME, we usually start with 3 injections every month to 6 weeks and add focal laser if indicated and possible, and continue with the injections if the patient shows progressive improvement, that is the visual acuity continues to improve or the OCT thickening continues to decrease. In case you're not getting a response, then you can switch anti-VEGF or add steroids if it's refractory, especially in the older or pseudophakic patients. We are not hesitant to employ steroids in addition in these cases. Once you have achieved a central foveal thickness of less than 250 microns and the visual acuity is good, say 6.9 or better and stable, then you can withhold treatment unless there is recurrence. Intravitreal steroids are effective as anti-capillary permeability factors and anti-inflammatory agents. We know the systemic steroids mostly can't be used in diabetics, and so intravitreal delivery is definitely preferred, and the agents most commonly used are triamcinolone and the dexamethasone slowly release pellet, that is Ozurdex. We don't normally now use steroids as the first line of treatment unless anti-VEGFs are contraindicated or if there is a gross edema, especially if this associated with marked CME and subsensory retinal fluid, or there's a non-response or poor response to anti-VEGF. Combination therapy, again, is common, sometimes used, and we often do use it, but there's no definitive evidence of a proven advantage of this in any sort of larger studies. We consider it in very gross macular edema or if there's none or poor response to both anti-VEGF and steroids. And if the patient responds, as we'll see in one of the cases later, then we can continue to give combination as well. Here we have a DME in this patient, and the OCT clearly shows the thickening. This is the right eye, this is the left eye of the same patient. He had received multiple anti-VEGF injections and also steroids. We gave a combination and this followed it up with deferred focal laser, and the patient responded well to this and has maintained both the reduction in macular edema and the visual acuity. The Ozurdex theoretically has a longer duration of action, but what we find most promising about it is that the raise in IOP seems to be much less than with triamcinolone, and that is a major advantage which we get with the slow-release dexamethasone. This is a patient going up to mention about how we followed him up for almost now more than eight and a half years. The patient has also been regular in follow-up. He presented to us first in 2006 with this picture and a little drop in vision. He was feeling blurred vision. That was time we hadn't even started anti-VEGFs. We gave intravitreal tricot and he had a good response as we see here. Now going through, we see that every time we gave him injections, the edema would decrease. At this stage, he had a cataract surgery before which we had given him a subtenon tricot. But then sometime later again, he started developing the edema. And he was not at this stage responding to anti-VEGF, so we gave him an anti-VEGF. And we found by trial and error that whenever we gave him a combination of anti-VEGF and triamcinolone, he responded well. So that is how we sort of followed him up with serial OCTs and intervened when every time his edema started increasing. So this is the progress to 2009. Again, we find here a dry macula recurrence, again giving him Avastin and triamcinolone. And again, we found that he required this about once in 6 months or so. And this is how the left eye progressed. Ultimately, this eye also went for cataract surgery in 2010. Here again, there was an increase in the macular edema in which he received a combination of Avastin and triamcinolone. Here we again find a marked increase in edema, although his vision still was not dropping so much, but again with injection, he would improve to almost 6.5 N5. And this patient is so sensitive that he would come back and almost tell you that he's come back and he needs an injection. And so he almost told you what to do. Here again, this is his edema coming back, and we repeated the Avastin and triamcinolone. The other thing we have to be careful in these cases is while treating the macular edema, we mustn't lose sight of the entire picture, because sometimes during all this is happening, they could be having proliferative retinopathy also. So in between here, we did a fluorescein angiography and saw the new vessels. And for that, we augmented the PRP and along with that, gave him in this situation where he had a lot of edema along with Avastin and triamcinolone, and here Avastin alone with additional laser. So this is the situation. Now, in this eye, interestingly, what happened was in the right eye, the posterior hyoid started separating, as you can see on the OCT. It's detached over the fovea and only attached here in one place. And at this stage, his requirement of repeat injections came down and his edema was not coming back in the right eye. But the left eye, again, periodically, we gave him an Ozurdex also at this stage, but he didn't respond too well to it. Again, responded better when we gave him Avastin and triamcinolone about 2 to 3 months later. The edema came down. And again, this was the combination he was responding to best. Strangely, although the edema didn't come back, this hyoid which had separated over this area thickened, and this caused him a lot of discomfort and visual symptoms. So ultimately, he underwent a vitrectomy for this in August last year. And after that has been stable. This is a patient with a proliferative retinopathy. Here we see the TRD on the OCT who underwent a vitrectomy for the PDR, but his PDR settled down, but post-operative you could see this macular edema which is gross. He didn't respond to Avastin or Keracort, but ultimately we gave him Ozodex, which is a slow release in these vitrectomized eyes. It works well, and his edema comes down, but every 4 months or so he requires a repeat injection of Ozodex. So this is how we are following him up. Ischemic maculopathy, you have to treat it on its merits. For that ischemic element, there's no treatment, but if there's concomitant edema, that has to be treated on its own merits. Here we see this gross, we know that the visual potential is poor, but if there is edema, simultaneously we should treat it. If there is a tractional element, then these eyes require surgery. This was a case which had proliferation as well, but you can see gross edema and taut hyaloid there. And after the vitrectomy, his edema has settled down and he's doing well. Thank you for your attention.